Yo, I'm Geda, and I'm developing a game in solo, and this month I've taken this landscape to the next level by adding vegetation and a lot of details everywhere. But before that, I had to make the switch to the new version of Unreal Engine, namely 5.4. The last update brings a lot of performance improvements, especially on the nanite and lumen side, that I wanted to take advantage. That wasn't the smoothest update for me so far, as the project started a long time ago and might have some compatibility issues with deprecated code or settings, yet I finally was able to test all the sweet new features of 5.4. The one I was most interested in at the moment was the improvement in performance for landscape tessellation. Tessellation dynamically subdivides a portion of a mesh based on the camera position. The closest it is to the camera, the denser the polygons. This way, I can deform the landscape with very fine details like pebbles and small rocks only where it matters. This kind of resolution would not have been possible with a static mesh, as it would require way too much triangles. 5.4 brought a lot of performance optimization to these features, and it seemed the perfect timing for me to test it now. So far so good, and it really adds a lot of nice and fine details. But I also need bigger props, like boulders. For that, I'm using Megascans assets that I bring in ZBrush to remove all those micro details that are too much and doesn't fit the art style I'm aiming for. After that, the workflow is pretty similar to the big cliff assets I showed in the previous recap video. I use Houdini to decimate the object, create UVs automatically, and then import it in Substance to bake maps and texture the assets. With this workflow, I can quickly create new prop under an hour of work, granted that I found a suited mesh in the Megascans library to begin with. And now it's the part where I'm scattering thousands of instances of those props in my level. Yeah, there's no way I'm doing this by hand. Luckily, I can once again use the magic of Houdini. I can create and manipulate masks there based on geological features like slope and erosion location. In this particular example, I can extract a mask of where debris are supposed to fall during an erosion simulation and scatter points procedurally in those areas. This point cloud can be then imported inside Unreal, where each point will be replaced by a boulder. How cool is that, honestly? It only takes a couple of minutes to add a thousand of rocks in my scene in a realistic and believable way. I can use this workflow for anything that needs to be scattered, like foliage or pebbles. Speaking of foliage and vegetation, I looked at a workflow to create trees. I didn't look too far because I once again used Houdini. But look how cool it is to generate thousands of variations of trees in a couple of clicks. Of course, the trickiest part is setting up the system so that it works flawlessly. Fortunately, there's already powerful tools available by default that allows to configure a trunk and add branches step by step, building a hierarchy. A trunk on which grows branches, on which grows all the branches, etc, etc. For the leaves, I can use the same system to spawn a bunch of leaf instances onto small branches and render this asset into a texture. The same texture is then applied on a card that is spawned multiple times all over my tree. This way, by using textured cards instead of individual leaf as geometry, I can save a lot on the polygons. Oh, and another pros for using Houdini for trees is that it can generate for me all the data needed to have a nice shader that simulates wind that moves branches individually. It's not just the whole tree that is uniformly bending, but each branch has their own deformations. Subtle, but nice, and it's relatively easy to set up. A bit of scattering magic, and just like that, I now have a nice environment. And to make things blend better, I learned a new Unreal trick called Runtime Virtual Texture, or RVT for the cool kids. It's usually used with landscapes, and basically it renders a material into a very large texture. That means you can build a complex and expensive shader, since at the end of the pipeline it's gonna be baked into a texture anyway. And another cool thing you can do with this rendered texture is to use it into props material that you want to blend with your landscape. You see here how we can clearly see the intersection between the mesh and the terrain? Well, I can now make a shader that projects the terrain texture on my object and mask it only around the intersection, making seamless integration of assets. Pretty good, eh? And that's it for this month. Please consider subscribing if you find this DevLog interesting. I'm also curious to know if you enjoy this type of content. Do you like videos that goes deep into the technical part of making a game? I was thinking that even for neophytes, it can be interesting to see just how much involvement a video game requires, and that perhaps it helps to appreciate the hard works of game developers. Thank you all for your support, and see you next month.